Very much. It's a great pleasure to be here, and it's an honor to open the symposium. So I was asked to give a somewhat educational talk, so that is what I will try to do. I will try to mix newer science with older science in an attempt to be somewhat pedagogical, and I will also say a few words about how to philosophically approach the study of mechanism in these transition metal active sites. So we are dealing with iron, and as you all know, iron is one of the most abundant, if not the most abundant, transition metal on Earth, and probably in space too. Iron occurs in many, many different forms, not only in enzymes. It occurs as metallic iron, where it is used in all kinds of devices. It's an important component of Mars. It's part of countless minerals. It's also a part of fool's gold, FeS2, that has been implicated in the origin of life, at least for quite a while. And then, of course, there are all these biological and chemical roles of iron in oxygen transport, in all kinds of biochemical reactions, in industrial catalysts, and in single molecule magnets, which leaps into material science. So there are many, many ways and many, many reasons why iron is such an important element. And one of the many reasons is it can exist in a great number of different oxidation states, so about 7, if not 8, oxidation states. And all of them have been observed, and all of them play roles. So we have the most common ones are definitely iron 2 and iron 3. They're most common in Werner-type complexes, and most enzyme active sites in their resting states, at least, are either in the iron 2 or the iron 3 states. Then there are the high valent iron sites that are iron 4. It has been observed in porphyrins and many model complexes. And I will talk a little bit about the discovery of superoxidized iron centers in the oxidation states 5 and 6. And I will also go to the other side, super reduced iron centers, presumably in the oxidation states of iron 1 and iron 0. So here are two iconic model complexes, one of Larry K that was the first crystallographically characterized iron 4 oxo complex. That was worth a science paper in 2003. And of course, it was preceded by many, many iron oxo porphyrins. And the idea here of these high valent iron sites is that they're very reactive. So, and the reactivity is of course such that it is present in all of these low molecular weight metal oxo species, but this reactivity is not directed. It is basically homogeneous, it's spherical. So these things can be attacked from every side, and that leads to undiscriminate reactivity that simply burns substrate. And what biology is better at than any human-made or man-made catalyst is that they're able to selectively make these highly oxidizing species and then funnel the reactivity at the exact place where it is desired, at the exact time it is desired. And that is something that is exceedingly hard to build into a molecular catalyst. So now, before we study now the actual mechanisms, and I wanted to spend a little bit of time telling you about how we approach these things as theoreticians and as spectroscopists. And today it is basically impossible to open a chemistry journal without every second article at least having a graphic like this. And so here you see here it's full of acronyms, so it's B3 lib D3 SDD plus 631 GDP the CPCM bonds. So somebody says this is what I've used, and then I've calculated my reactants and I've calculated my products, and in between I've calculated all my intermediates and all my transition states, and here it goes 6.5 kcal up, and then it goes to minus 7, and then it goes to plus 0.2, and it's kcal, etc. And this is so because I've calculated it. And of course, nothing is ever a certain way because somebody has calculated it. So the question that begs to be asked here is, how do you know? Right? I mean, we're in science. We're not in the business of believing. And the fact that somebody did a calculation on a mechanism he liked proves exactly nothing. And so I wanted to put that in a little bit into perspective. And so let's look at this small organic molecule. That small organic molecule has a total energy of about 300,000 kcal per mole. What does it mean, 300,000 kcal per mole? That means if you take that molecule and separate all electrons and all nuclei into infinite distance where they don't interact anymore, it will cost you 290,668 kcal per mole. So that's a big number. You never ever do that experiment, so you never measure these numbers. But you do small changes on these molecules. Yes, you change one bond, you change things by one electron, maybe two. And then you calculate the energies. And so you've seen, like in the slide before, these energies go up a few kcal, go down a few kcal. And so for every error of 1.3 kcal per mole that I make in calculating this big energy here, I predict a pK value that's off by one log unit. I predict a redox potential that's off by 56 millivolts, or I predict a reaction rate that's off by a factor of 10. And so that's modest accuracy in terms of chemistry, but it's crazy accuracy in terms of how accurately I have to compute that energy. Let me put that into further perspective. So this is a Queen Mary 2 that weighs about 56 million kilograms, and that's me on a good day, it's 80 kilograms. And I'm not joking. Right? And so computing this number accurately means you weigh the Queen Mary with and without me to figure out my way to an accuracy of 0.1 kilograms. And that is crazy hard to do. And so this is about the extent to which you have to believe these numbers that people publish when they like calculate these mechanisms. So a calculated reaction mechanism in the absence of experimental support is essentially poetry. And so there are possible consequences, and these possible consequences, either you need an extremely accurate theory that really delivers you this number to an accuracy of 1 kcal per mole. And it is true, it is possible to do that these days. So quantum chemists have learned to really nail this energy to this crazy accuracy, but not for molecules of any larger size. So you can do that for 2, 3, 4 molecules. So that's why the field of astrochemistry and astrophysics is hugely benefiting from this accuracy that you're getting there. And you're getting that not out of chance. This is not fitting, this is not parameterization, that's not quasar, that's not any of these things. This is solving the Schrödinger equation, and these numbers are that accurate because you have really solved the quantum mechanics. It is a long time into the future that we can do that for enzymes or biological molecules, but I think it's essentially understood how to do that. Secondly, you need very good error compensation. The reality of it is that's really what we're living off, all of us, and as theoretical chemists. But there is a more interesting alternative, and that more interesting alternative will be the guiding theme of the talk. And that is to care about other properties than the total energy, right? The total energy is just the grand total of absolutely everything that's going on. But there is so much more to a molecule. There is so much more to a catalyst. There is so much more to understand. There is so much more to look at. And there is so much more that you can then use to find out whether any proposed mechanism is reasonable or not. And that is the main theme of what I'm doing. So in principle, whether it's biological catalysis or homogeneous catalysis or even heterogeneous catalysis, you often have a very good idea of where you start and where you end, so about reactants and products. And the chemical magic here is in the reaction intermediates. And you're not going to be able to crystallize these reaction intermediates because by their nature they're fleeting and they don't put themselves in crystal and let themselves be investigated. That means you have to rely on spectroscopy, and after years of work you may have like a noisy spectrum, and it's entirely obvious that from this one spectrum you cannot possibly reconstruct all the coordinates, the three-dimensional structure of that reaction intermediate. So the thing to do here is to ask a more modest question. The question, what is the structure, is not modest enough. The right question is to ask is like, which structures are consistent with what I have observed? Okay, and that's fundamentally different. So that means you can use your chemical intelligence to make proposals of how that reaction intermediate could look like. Then you can calculate the spectroscopic property, and then you can compare it to the experiment. And only in the case that your calculation disagrees with the experiment, within the error limits of the methodology that you use, you can exclude that structure. So you never have a positive proof for it, right? You only have a negative proof. And you only have a negative proof if you understand the error bar of your calculation very well. And that means you have to like carefully calibrate your theoretical methodology. So blind trust in any calculational result is never warranted, right? And it also means, of course, the more spectroscopic techniques you can lay your hand on, the more spectroscopic properties you calculate, the better is your falsification, right? And it's never getting any better than that. You falsify, you don't verify. And that is very important. So of the things you can connect to as a theoretician in the real world, you have the thermodynamics, and the thermodynamics, of course, of a catalyzed reaction, that is basically the free energy change by going from reactants to products. That does not involve the catalyst, so it doesn't tell you anything about the mechanism. Then you have the individual kinetic rates, and in certain isolated cases, you have these rates, but this is like a grand effort, and for a given reaction, it takes years and decades sometimes to extract these. If they are available, they're a great thing to connect to. But what I'm saying is there are libraries full of spectra that wait to be interpreted. There are libraries full of spectroscopic properties that you can connect to. And of all the ways you can connect theory to experiment, by far my favorite is spectroscopy. And that is what I want to demonstrate. And it is really important to seek that connection to experiment. Let's remind us what Karl Popper said. He said, "But I shall certainly admit a system as empirical or scientific only if it is capable of being tested by experience," right, by experiment. "These considerations suggest that not verifiability, but the falsifiability of a system is to be taken as a criterion of demarcation." So Popper is saying that anything that cannot be experimentally disproven isn't science. That's a very hard statement. I don't think I would be as extreme as Popper. So let's speak with Max Planck, and he says that experiments are the only source of knowledge at our disposal. The rest is poetry and imagination. And that's a very smart and very, very good statement. And basically what he's telling us is that we should make a difference between those things that we can observe and those things that help us being creative. So let me put it this way. So the world basically here divides into two types of properties. Those that are observable, that would be a dissociation energy or a dipole moment or a chemical shift or molecular mass or an excitation energy, and those you can measure, and they have well-defined values, and then you calculate them and you're either right or wrong. There is no middle ground. Within the error limits that the experiment quotes, these are numbers you can't argue with. But that's not good enough. If you would only do science this way, we never would get anywhere, because in science we need models, we need oversimplifications, we need pictures, we need a language that helps us thinking. And these are the interpretation aids. And all of us in chemistry, we're educated and we're used to using these things. These are things like resonance, hybridization, orbitals, partial charges, bond orders, ligand fields, pi systems. None of these things have any rigorous quantum mechanical definition, right? So none of these things have any objective existence. But they are necessary for us to think chemically, creatively, and this is what Max Planck means. So this is a part of poetry and imagination, right? And this is a part where the experiment is giving you the answer. So, and I find it really important to be aware of these things, and I know that this is something that really isn't taught in university curriculum anywhere worldwide, but please take this serious. It's really the foundation of everything we're doing here in science. If you're interested in that, I've recently written an article in Angewandte Chemie where I explain that. And so, coming back to a slide that I've shown earlier, in the workshop during the teaching, I've explained to you that using this type of thinking, you can make full circle by going from geometric structure to electronic structure, and then from electronic structure to spectroscopy, because spectroscopy is the experimental way of studying electronic structure, but then electronic structure is intimately related to reactivity. So basically, by studying the spectroscopy experimentally, you get an experimental picture of electronic structure that you can then can correlate to reactivity and can correlate to geometric structure. And basically, in my lecture, in the workshop, I've basically gone from here to here, and in this lecture, I also want to go to the reactivity. So let's first look at iron and what spectroscopic properties we have available, and this is quite a bit. So iron is a very fortunate case, so it's great that iron is so important in biochemistry because there are so many methods to study it. So first of all, of course, with iron there is Mohs power spectroscopy, and you've learned about that from Eckhart. And there is nuclear resonance vibrational spectroscopy. It's a fancy way of measuring vibrational spectra with a synchrotron using the Mohs power effect. Then there's X-ray absorption spectroscopy and EXAS, which you have heard about from Serena. There's magnetic circular dichrism spectroscopy, especially for the paramagnetic states of iron, which you have heard about from Nikolai. There is resonance Raman spectroscopy, which you have heard about from Hannah. And there is absorption spectroscopy. And so that is a very, very powerful way of connecting theory and experiment. And for the rest of the talk, I will use all of these techniques in order to get insight into reactivity. So let's start our story with the oxidation state of iron 4. And this is, so basically I'm only signing holiday application forms these days, so all of the work I'm telling you about has been done by other people, and I just have the privilege to talk about it. And so this work was done in particular by Sheng Fa Yi, who's a group leader in our department, and my old friend Eckhard Bill, who has taught me everything I know about spectroscopy, and in collaboration with Larry Kay and Frank Meyer, who were synthetic chemists on the project. And so that brings us to the subject of non-heme iron oxo four sites that I've basically mentioned in passing in the beginning of the talk. And there's a general theme by which these iron enzymes work. And the general theme is that you start from a six-coordinate resting state that is ferrous, and that is unreactive towards dioxygen because it's coordinatively saturated. This is the way of the enzyme to prevent Fenton chemistry. Then substrate binds, and the enzyme has a cool trick to kick out one of the ligands to open up the coordination site where O2 can bind. Then in the presence of substrate, form a hot high-valent species that then attacks substrate and leading to products. And that is a consensus mechanism that in one way or another has been found in very many of these enzymes. So perhaps most prominent one, this is Tau D, studied here at Penn State in great detail, methane monooxygenase, or you have the intermediate X in ribonucleotide reductase. And these findings of biology have greatly inspired chemists who have tried to make model compounds. And it took a long time, but finally now there is a wide array of low molecular weight coordination compounds available that carry these iron 4 oxosites. That was the first one, you've already seen it from Larry Kay. And most of these have a ground state spin of 1. I'm going to elaborate why this is important in a moment. And there are all kinds of mononuclear and dinuclear compounds. The specific chemistry that I want to discuss today is Larry Kay's chemistry. And it starts all with this compound that Larry made in the 90s, and that was the iron 3-4 diamond core, at the time a hotly debated model for intermediate Q in MMO. And Larry has greatly followed up on that chemistry by producing many variants of that. For example, if you oxidize it by one electron, you can go to the 4-4 diamond core. You add fluoride, you open it up into an open core, oxofluoro, or with hydroxide, under basic conditions, you go to an oxohydroxo 3-4 core that you can also then oxidize to the 4-4. So that is a wide array of iron 4 sites, and fortunately Larry has measured the reactivity of all of these species towards CH bonds, and there is a fascinating correlation here, and he's showing that the reactivity of these iron 4 sites, they all have the same active species, iron 4 oxo, yet their reactivity like varies by 8 orders of magnitude. So that is the rate constant for CH abstraction, and it's varying by 8 orders of magnitude. So right here in the middle is a mononuclear iron 4 oxo compound, and then the most reactive one is the 3-4 fluoro, and the least reactive one is the 3-4 diamond core. Now, we will focus first on the mononuclear compounds, and then at the end try to come up with some speculation that might explain these reactivity trends. So the questions that beg to be asked here are the following. So if you compare the mononuclear iron 4 oxo with the 4-4 oxo hydroxo, why would these be so similar? And more intriguing even, like, so you have a 4-4 oxohydroxo site that is far less reactive than the 3-4 oxohydroxo. And why would that be, right? You would expect that the higher Lewis acidity of the 4,4 would be a more reactive side than the 3,4, but it's not. It's far less reactive than than the 3,4 hydroxyl. So why would then the fluoro oxo be more reactive than the hydroxyl oxo? Why would the open core be more reactive than the closed core? So these are all really interesting chemical questions, because chemistry is all about the subtleties. And then, of course, the related question on a different axis is, what's the reactivity of these iron 4 oxosides in mononuclear case? How do they depend on ligands, and how do they depend on spin? And that is what we will first discuss before coming back to all of the other questions. So there are electronic structure contributions to reactivity in these mononuclear iron 4 oxo systems that has been studied by many people, many theoreticians and experimentalists. And so I will only give you a bird's eye view of that. You will probably find that this is like extremely detailed, but there is a lot more detail under the hood that I'm not mentioning, but I hope that the major themes come through here. So when you talk about CH atom abstraction by these iron 4 oxosides, then there is a consensus mechanism that is the Groves rebound mechanism, by which goes as follows. So you start from the iron 4 oxo and the CH bond in the substrate. You do H atom abstraction to go to the iron 3 hydroxo side that then undergoes rebound to hydroxylated product. And the rate limiting step here is the first one, the abstraction of the hydrogen atom. Now, these iron 4 oxosides, they can exist in a variety of different spin states. And so they either have a ground state spin of 1 or a ground state spin of 2. And I've shown a third spin state here, a septet state. That is really odd, because a septet state should never occur for a mononuclear transition metal side. But these septet states, they are high in energy at the reactants, but they're coming down in energy at the first transition state, and they may get kinetically competitive. That is a big story in the reaction mechanism of tau d, but I will keep on ignoring the septet state. If you want to, we can discuss it a bit later in the discussion. So that is then the consensus mechanism, and we have to worry about different spin states. So let's take a look into the electronic structure. That is essentially something that Harry Gray has figured out in the early 1960s on the basis of extended trickle calculations. He was studying vanadil. And most of these iron, like metal oxosides, they all have the same electronic structure, where you have the lowest energy orbital in the d set is a dxy orbital that is either singly or doubly occupied. The next set is strongly pi antibonding, so you have the dxz and dyz orbital at the metal, and they're strongly pi antibonding to the p orbitals of the oxygen. The next one then is a strongly sigma antibonding orbital dx squared minus y squared, that is sigma antibonding with the ligands in the plane, and the highest energy orbital in the d set is a dz squared orbital that is strongly sigma antibonding with the pz orbital of of the oxygen. Now, iron 4 has 4d electrons, and now I can fill them in here in two different ways. Either I fill them in to doubly occupy the dxy orbital, which would give me a ground state triplet spin, s equal 1, or I can move one electron from here to here, that would give me 4 unpaired electrons and a total spin of 2. And it depends on the ligand set here which one of these two is the ground state. And they differ remarkably in their reactivity, and the reason for that will become apparent soon. So now let's look at that. Even for the seemingly simple case of metal oxoside, now we have two different modes of substrate attack. The substrate can either attack from the top or from the side. And you have three different multiplicities to talk about. So that means there are 6 different reaction channels that can be explored. So 6 different ways in which a single metal oxoside can react with a simple CH bond. So that's probably a level of complexity that you haven't expected, and that probably that took people quite a while to appreciate. And why is that? Now let's look at these electron shift diagrams. That's the easiest way to picture that. Now let's have the substrate come from top. And then what's happening, so if you have an s equals 2 side, so you have a spin of 2 ground states, 4 unpaired electrons at the iron 4 side, then the electron will be transferred from the CH bond of the substrate into the empty dz squared orbital, because this is what then will overlap with the CH bond. Yeah. On the other hand, if you come from the side, you have a triplet ground state, then an electron will be transferred from the CH bond to the dxz and yz orbitals. Now there's a constraint here, right? Because these orbitals are already occupied with a spin-up electron, so you can only transfer a spin-down electron into these orbitals. Whereas here, when you transfer into an empty orbital, it can be either spin-up or spin-down. And that makes a very big difference, as you will see in a moment. And then, of course, if you just by pure permutation, then you can also play the opposite game. If you have a triplet ground state, you can, of course, if you come from top, transfer an electron into the dz squared orbital, or if you come from the side, you can transfer an electron into the dxz orbitals if you have an s equals 2 ground state. So all of these four possibilities exist. And Chengfa, yeah, he was the first in a model system to find all four of these transition states. And that is important, and it's also really, really interesting. So what you see here is then in that model system, the triplet ground state and a very, very low-lying quintet state slightly on top of it. Now he has found all four of these transition states with a very high accuracy theoretical method. And interestingly, it's a quintet sigma transition state. So if you have the s equals 2 ground state and you come from top, that is far and away the lowest in energy, followed by the triplet pi. So if you have a triplet ground state and you come from the side, that is the second one. And the other two ones that were more hypothetical, they're higher in energy. Now that also means the following. So if that system starts out in a triplet ground state, the best way for the system to proceed is to switch to the quintet surface and go via a quintet transition state. And that is the concept of two-state reactivity that has become very popular from the work of Helmut Schwarz and Sasson Chaik, who have first observed that in gas phase chemistry of naked FeO plus with H2. And it is something that is not easily found experimentally, so you really have to search for it, but it's certainly a concept that carries very far in transition metal chemistry and also in organometallic chemistry. And it has to be on the radar, because that is quite important that the total spin is not conserved during the reaction. So now, in this case, the products end up on a quintet surface, so that spin must occur. But in the case of FeO plus plus H2, then you start from a sextet, you end with a sextet, and intermediately everything runs on a quartet surface. So that is hard to see, but the very odd trends in reactivity along the transition metal series that Helmut has observed in his gas phase experiment only could be explained this way. Now, why would then this quintet sigma state be so more stable than the triplet pi? Because taken phase value, you take an electron out of the CH bond and move it into the energetically most destabilized orbital in the D set. And the reason for that is twofold. So first of all, if you come from top, you have less steric hindrance. That's basically trivial. But the more important component why that is the lowest energy transition state is the following. You are able to transfer a spin-up electron into that orbital, and that creates five unpaired electrons that are all spin aligned. And that leads to a huge exchange stabilization. You may know that like there is a stabilization for each pair of like unpaired spin up electrons. And that really is what drives that transition state way down in energy. So it's not something that you see from the orbital scheme. That's not something that you can possibly see in the geometric structure of these things. This is a purely electronic effect that you have to be aware of. So in principle, these things want to react by having a quintet ground state, and they want to react by being attacked from top, so the sigma pathway. Now, equipped with that, let's look into some interesting model chemistry, and that was ligand variations in the iron 4 oxo series. Now, Frank Meyer and his colleagues, they made a very interesting class of our new iron oxo compound that's a carbene iron oxo ferrylside. So these carbene ligands, they have been very modern in coordination chemistry. Everybody has been using them, and a lot of interesting chemistry has been explored. And Frank and his co-workers, they were able to make this compound here that has a carbene ligand iron 4 site, has a triplet ground state. And when you compare it to Larry's compound, which is the amine oxo iron 4, so that's basically just cyclam here with some axial ligand, in this case acetonitrile. And so for this there is a structure, for this there is also a structure, and you see that these iron oxo bond distances, they're nearly identical. And they both have a triplet ground state, yet you will see in a moment that these compounds are totally different. And there was a fair bit of characterization. Funny enough, it was really hard to measure the vibrational frequency of that iron-oxygen bond. That was finally achieved by infrared photodissociation spectroscopy by Jana Reutova, who also isotope labeled that compound. And so from that, these experiments, we know that the carbene oxo has a vibrational frequency of 832 wave numbers, which is exceedingly close to 839 wave numbers measured for the amine oxo. So the distance is the same, the stiffness is the same. So for all intents and purposes, like, these two iron oxygen bonds are just identical. Now, Frank has studied the reactivity of these compounds. So they're reacting these compounds, so first make the iron 4, and then reacted with dihydroanthracene, which is a standard reaction because it can be spectroscopically followed nicely, and then measure the rate of that. Unfortunately, or fortunately, I don't know, there is also a side reaction that forms a dimer. But this is just to show you that you can really nicely follow the production of the iron 3 hydroxide, which arises from the CH atom abstraction. And so you have clean kinetics, and you can nicely follow it. So by playing all the tricks of the trade, then just like varying temperature, isotope labeling, etc., using different substrates with different CH bond strengths, they were able to come up with all of the activation parameters, delta G, delta S, and delta H for that reaction. Now, what you see here then is that his compound is a little less reactive than Larry's. But it's less than two orders of magnitude. Quoting Harry Gray, he always says, in kinetics you don't lose friends over an order of magnitude. That's probably true, and even if you have two different labs measure the same reaction, they typically come out, if on a good day, within a factor of 10. So I would say, is that right, Joanne? It's too much. factor of 3, 5? 2? Factor of 2, okay. If you're as good as Joanne, then you can do it with a factor of 2. If you're me, it's an order of magnitude. Well, anyways, so by all intents and purposes, like Frank's compound, it's a little bit less reactive than Larry's. Now, there are still very interesting differences, and so if you put that in the computer, you see something that you may or may not have anticipated, and that is that these things, these two compounds have distinct electronic structure. So that is the amine iron oxo, that has the canonical classical orbital structure that I've shown you, dxy orbital doubly occupied, triplet ground state, dx squared minus y squared, dz squared. Now, the occupied orbitals here for the carbene compound are the exact same, right? So it's a dxy orbital and then dxzyz, and they basically look the same. But now the first unoccupied orbital here is the dz squared orbital, according to the calculation, whereas the dx squared minus y squared orbital is higher in energy. So this is classic, this is not classic. So why is that important? And it's so what you see in the ground state here, like, the electronic structure is the same, and that of course accounts for the fact that, like, the bond distance is the same, vibrational frequency is the same, and everything. But it starts to matter once you start filling these unoccupied orbitals, and that is what will happen in these during the reactivity. Now, that is a hypothesis that's coming from the calculation, and now you have to gather some experimental evidence that this model is correct. And so how do you do that? Because the unoccupied orbitals, they don't mean anything unless you occupy them. And how do you occupy them? One way is doing chemistry and the other way is doing spectroscopy. So you can excite electrons within the D shell into these unoccupied orbitals. And so here's an enumeration of all of the states that arise by exciting an electron from the dxy orbital or the dxyz orbital into these empty orbitals. Now the important thing here is that this first E state in these two compounds is then seen to be of different origin. In the amine, this excitation goes into the dx squared minus y squared orbital to form an E state, whereas in the carbene, this would go to the dz squared orbital to form an E state. Now, if you do an absorption experiment, then you like see an absorption band and you say, aha, there is an absorption band and it's like a blob, and that blob doesn't tell you anything about what it is, right? So it doesn't label itself. So I arise from exciting an electron to the dx squared minus y squared, and I arise from exciting electron in the dz squared. But there is a smart experiment where you can really distinguish these two possibilities, and that smart experiment is MCD spectroscopy, right? Because MCD spectroscopy is a signed quantity, so you see these bands have positive and negative sign. Now, when you excite an electron from the dxyz orbitals to either the x squared minus y squared or the z squared, you get a pair of bands, right? So that's why it's an E state, it's doubly degenerate. Now, in MCD spectroscopy, that shows up as a so-called pseudo-A term, like a pair of positive and negative bands. And so what you see here, first of all, is that these calculations that we're doing, they're reproducing this structure here. So it's up-down in the amine and it's down-up in the carbene. And that's great because it means something. We can interpret that. And I will show you a very scary slide now it's not supposed for you to understand. It's only to show that these things can be analyzed. So this is something that Nikolai might have talked about in the MCD lecture. These are rules from that I derived way back in the 90s to figure out what the sign of these MCD bands would be. And so, essentially in a nutshell, without going into any of these details, so in the amine oxo, you expect a negative pseudo-A term, so up-down, whereas in the carbene, you expect a positive MCD pseudo-A term, so down-up. And that comes simply out of like the basic rules of angular momentum coupling in quantum mechanics. And so that is great. So if our hypothesis then is right, that like the first like orbital that can be occupied, the LUMO in the amine and the carbene is different, then the MCD spectroscopy will tell it. And it actually does. So what you see here is nice, it's really nice. So this pseudo-A term arises from the dxyz excitation into dz squared, and that's basically at the same energy for both the amine and the carbene. Yeah, so that is at around 20,000 wave numbers, and it's down up in both cases. However, look at this here now. In the amine, the excitation dxyz to x squared minus y squared is to the lower energy side of the dz squared excitation, where it is on the high energy side for the carbene. So basically that is then an experimental, I don't want to say proof because it's a model, but it's a strong experimental hint that these electronic structures really differ in the way that I've indicated. And so that to me is a thing of beauty. So this is like where I love doing theory and trying, here I feel, I look at the spectroscopy and I understand the electronic structure. So now what are we making out of that? And I want to make a short digression. So now I've these calculations and they agree with the experiment and that's nice. And I want to quote a gentleman of the name Charles Coulson, who gave a very famous after dinner speech at a conference in 1959. Now you say, oh Jesus Christ, 1959. But look it up on the internet, like this man had a foresight that is unreal. Then it's basically everything he said in 1959 could be transferred to today, and it's still true, unchanged. Everything he's saying is absolutely still true today. And one of the famous quotes, so this thing is like full of famous quotes, but one of the famous quotes saying, give us insight, not numbers. So what he means, and that is even more true today than it was 1959, you have like these things, people like dump everything in the computer and let the computer run, and then the computer says something and say, look, this is so because the computer told me so. And Coulson was already complaining about that at a day and age where like the computer, the largest supercomputer was far less powerful than your cell phone. And I don't know what he would say today, but probably he would make a much, much stronger statement even. So, and I want to transport that into the problem that we have at hand. So here's a spectrum that was measured by my friend Thomas Brunold a long time ago when he was doing his PhD in Switzerland. That's the absorption spectrum of FeO42 minus doped in a crystal. And so you see there are all kinds of bands here. Some of them are of DD origin, and some of them correspond to ligand to metal charge transfer. Now we want to do ligand field theory because we want to do the dance of the electrons inside the D shell. So part of that then is covered by ligand field theory. All of these peaks that are in green, whereas all of these charge transfer transitions in blue, they're not covered by ligand field theory. So essentially what I want to do then is I want to have a model that explains these D2D excitations to me. That is what we have observed in these iron complexes. Now I can make a calculation and it agrees with the experiment and I've labeled it BGOSD2867-2KP and that stands for big old super duper calculation. So whatever it is, right, it's like whatever calculation and it agrees with experiment. And so you say, aha, it agrees with the experiment. And let me quote another gentleman, that was Eugene Wigner, who said, it's nice to know that the computer understands the problem, but I would like to understand it too. So, no kidding, this is a serious problem then, is right? And so now the name of the game is then to find a connection that like connects the big old super duper calculation to the models that we're using. And that was something that I've been struggling to do for all my life, and in this case we've managed to do that. And so we have found a connection between the first principles electronic structure, in our case it's called not BGOSD, it's called CASSCF and FPD2 for the experts. And what it does, I can now get from that calculation in a unique way all of the ligand field parameters that characterize that compound. And then of course you can go from the experiment to the calculation to the actual ligand field parameters, and I will show you in a second why that's significant. So basically the workflow here is you do that calculation and without anything from the user side, it will predict for you the ligand field parameters, and this is like the 10dQ that we talked about in the ligand field lecture, the RACA parameters and also the spin orbit coupling parameters. And then I can interpret that in chemical terms. And why have I told you that? When I apply that now to the case of the amine and the carbene iron oxos, basically I can take the big old super duper calculation and reconstruct the orbital scheme from that. So that is not something that's arbitrary. I didn't pull this out of my pocket, and it's not something that's based on visual thinking. This is really the result of analyzing a calculation that is in eminent agreement with the experiment, namely the MCD spectrum. And it shows us exactly that, that in the amine, the dx squared minus y squared orbital is way lower in energy than in the carbene. And now I can even make that quantitative by analyzing that, because that calculation will give you the so-called AOM parameters that talk to you about the sigma and pi donor strengths of each of these ligands. And I can get from these calculations then the fact that the carbene is a way better sigma donor than the amine. So of course if your coordination chemistry said, wow, that took him an hour to arrive there, I would have known that right away. But look, this is not something based on feeling, right? This is something that is based on the actual analysis of tangible physical data. Carbenes are often credited for being then pi acceptors, and like all kinds of chemistry is explained by that. But in this case, by binding to these high valent metal ions, the pi acceptor property of carbenes is completely unimportant. What really matters is that these are brilliant, nice, wonderful sigma donors, and that is the reason why the dx squared minus y squared orbital is so far destabilized. So, now, what does it mean then? So it means that we have basically figured out, and I hope I've convinced you, that we really have this electronic structure situation here where the amine and the carbene differ by the nature of the first unoccupied orbital. And that, of course, has the first consequence that, like, if you want to go from the triplet to the quintet state, you can do that easily in the amine because the dx squared minus y squared orbital is low-lying. But you can absolutely not do that in the carbene. This is not drawn to scale. So the dz squared orbital is basically still at the same place, just the dx squared minus y squared is way up. So there is a low-lying quintet state here, but there is no low-lying quintet state here. Aha, and that now makes a big difference in terms of the reactivity, right? And so now if you calculate what the reactivity is, now you're at the mercy of the computer essentially, unless you have experimental data. So you see that here you're starting out in the amine in a triplet state, and then the transition state you go over is the quintet transition state, right? So just as I've shown you in the model system, the lowest energy transition state for the H atom abstraction is the quintet state. So there must be two-state reactivities. So there is no other way in the amine system can react than via two-state reactivity. Now, and that is possible because the quintet state here is just a few kcal per mole higher in energy than the ground state. Don't worry about these numbers. And that is absolutely not the case for the carbene here, where the quintet state is somewhere here, and you cannot possibly reach any transition state in the quintet that is kinetically competitive. So the only viable way this thing can react is to go via a triplet transition state. In this case, a triplet sigma transition state is the one that is that is the one that's kinetically relevant. Now, So the reactivity then is such that this is even in qualitative agreement with the experiment that the reactivity of this one is slightly higher than here. But remember, this one will be slowed down by having to cross from the triplet to the quintet surface. So there is an inter-system crossing involved that is spin forbidden and requires spin orbit coupling. So there is a transmission coefficient that is significantly smaller than one. So basically, this system can afford having a higher energy transition state than this system here while still being kinetically competitive. And the reason for that is that this one doesn't have to cross over to the quintet surface, whereas this one does. So that is interesting reactivity. It's quite detailed, but I hope that it makes sense to you that, like, by using the combination of theory and spectroscopy, you can really convincingly dissect that. Now, returning to the iron 4 oxo landscape, we have gone through all of this in like exasperating detail, but I will just now brush over it. I only wanted to show you one in more detail. So now the reactivity towards H atom abstraction. So basically all of the time we have spent so far, we've talked about the iron 4 oxo monomer. Now let's address the question, why is it so similar to the iron 4 oxo hydroxo dimer? And to do that, we have studied that both theoretically, the dimer, theoretically, and spectroscopically. And the first thing that you notice is that the iron 4 oxo side has local, this one here has a local spin state, which is a triplet. So, and that that looks very, very similar to the amine monomer. Yeah. Okay. So overall, there is a quintet ground state, which is great because then you can do MCD spectroscopy, and there's very rich MCD spectra of these dimers, and we spend a long time analyzing this. I'm embarrassed to tell you when Larry sent us the samples, but it was. It was before 2010, I can tell you that. Then is and then we have spent a long time measuring and analyzing these data. So this is detailed VTVH data. Nikolai has told you how to interpret that. So essentially, we could figure out the polarization of all of these bands and et cetera. I come to assignments. And then we can reconstruct the ligand fields of the iron 4 oxoside and the iron 4 hydroxoside in the dimer. And what is striking here is that the electronic structure of the iron 4 oxoside then is exceedingly similar with minor variations to the amine oxo monomer. But of course, it's different from the iron for the iron 4 hydroxoside. And it's a similarity of this electronic structure that we think is responsible for the fact that the chemistry that is happening at the iron 4 oxoside really is quite similar to the reactivity of the monomer. So essentially, this like acts, this dimer acts as the iron 4 oxo monomer. This is a bit hand wavy, but there is more to the argument. But I think this is the essence of how we explain that. So now let's, without presenting any more theoretical evidence, trust me, it exists. Let's go back to that side. So now we have addressed the question, what is the ligand and spin state dependence on the iron 4 oxomonomer? And I think we have at least presented a little bit of evidence that it is the local electronic structure that makes the iron 4 oxoside in the dimer similar to the iron 4 oxomonomer. Now, the difference between the oxohydroxo and the fluoroxo is also easy to explain. We have a separate paper on that, and the essence of that is the following. In the oxohydroxo, you form a hydrogen bond between the hydrogen of the OH group and the oxo group. And en route to the transition state, when you do H atom abstraction, you first must break this hydrogen bond, and that costs you energy. So basically, and you don't have to do that in the fluoro derivative, right? There is no hydrogen bond to break here. And the main reason why then this is more reactive than this is that you have to dig yourself out of that hydrogen bonding situation en route to the transition state before you can reach it. And that's why you don't have to do it here. That's why this is more reactive. Now, this one is also relatively easy to explain. Here in the diamond core, we really think it's the enhanced Lewis acidity of the iron 4-4 side that is responsible for the 4-4 being more reactive. The interesting question here between the iron 3-4 oxohydroxo and the iron 4-4 oxohydroxo, that really is now a subtlety. Because what the spectroscopy shows you is that this one here exists locally, the iron oxoside, in a triplet state. And I've done my best to explain to you that a quintet ground state would be way more reactive. And this is exactly what is happening here. So in the iron 3-4 oxohydroxo, the iron 4 side locally is in a high spin state. And that is very clear from the spectroscopy. So essentially, while the geometric structure almost doesn't change, the electronic structure is changing. So essentially, you add an electron, and as a result, the iron 4 side is going high spin. And the reason for that is that, like, once you have a high spin iron 3 side, you can gain energy by antiferromagnetic coupling. And so you benefit in terms of the antiferromagnetic coupling by having more unpaired electrons on the iron 4 side. But at the same time, then, you turn on the intrinsically high quintet state reactivity at the iron 4 side. So that is something that is entirely non-obvious before you dig into the electronic structure. It is something that took us quite a while to understand, but after the fact, I think it is quite illuminating and it's very clear. Now, the open versus closed core is something that is at this point more speculation than anything else. The evidence is building up that the open core is more reactive than the closed core. It probably has to do with larger reorganization energy that you require to break open the closed core. But I think this is something that really requires a lot more analysis. So that's our story here on the iron 4 reactivity, and now I want to go to the other oxidation states of iron, and so I first want to do iron 5 and iron 6. And iron 5 and iron 6, they have been implicated with nitrido complexes, so N3 minus instead of O2 minus. Of course, not in these extreme oxidation states, but they have been suggested as intermediates in nitrogenase. Whether that is true or not, I think, is completely open to debate. But they have there's good evidence that they occur in the Schrock catalyst, you know, the catalyst that converts dinitrogen to ammonia in model chemistry. And I think at least here it's clear that there is a molybdenum nitrido intermediate. Whether there is any such thing in nitrogenase, I don't know. And nitrido complexes have been intensely like thought after in coordination chemistry, and people have made quite an array of interesting metal nitrido complexes. Here is a small selection of them. Carsten Meyer and Vogel in 2008 have made an iron 4 nitrido. Then there's a very interesting chemistry by Ted Bedley and Jonas Peters, who have made these interesting mononuclear and then dinuclear nitrogen complexes. And there's also catalytic formation of ammonia by one of Jonas Peters' system that is somewhat newer. So there's quite some interesting in metal nitrido species, and I'll show you now some ancient work that we have done together with Carl Wiechardt when we were all together at the MPI. And that's a generation and characterization of high valent iron 5 and 6 nitrido species. And the story starts with a beautiful paper that Carsten Meyer has published during his PhD with Carl Wiechardt, and of course Eckhardt was involved in that, and Bernd and Thomas, so the whole team of the MPI. And at that time, they were looking at the chemistry of iron 3 azide complexes that can be activated by light to split off N2 and then give you what is probably best described as an iron 5 nitrido. And well, here are some EPR spectra that are probably less than pretty, and I know it has bugged Eckhardt for a long time. These EPR spectra have been haunting you for a long, long time. But the product of this reaction was described as a spin 3 half iron nitrido species. And since it was never possible to get better spectroscopy than that, I think they have been going after alternative systems. And these alternative systems were a cyclam acetate ligand. So here's cyclam with an acetate arm, and it forms like a nice azido complex that looks like that. Structure is known, spectroscopy is known, etc. And you can illuminate that compound either in frozen solution or in the solid state. And then the question is, are you forming the nitrido species? And the first evidence for that this is really the case comes from Mössbauer spectroscopy, where you have an entirely perfectly normal low spin iron 3 Mössbauer spectrum for the azido complex. And then you go to something with a slightly negative isomer shift in the photolysis product. And so the photolysis is fairly clean. And so that is certainly evidence that a high valent state of iron is formed. So that is consistent with a high valent species. And then at the time we did X-ray absorption spectroscopy together with Serena, that is very beautiful data. And here's the correlation that has been made many, many times. I will rely on it a little bit later also too. So it's the pre-edge peak here in these iron complexes is known to shift by about 1 electron volt per oxidation state. And as you see, this is really textbook, because for the known crystallographically spectroscopically characterized iron 3 complex, Fe cyclam acetate nitrido, it's at 7,112 electron volts. Then for an oxo compound that you can also make in that series, it's at 7,113, and the photolysis product is 7,114. So basically just 1 electron volt per oxidation state. So that's a solid evidence that the photolysis product is really best described as an iron 5. And the X-halves also shows that there definitely is a short iron nitrogen bond of about 1.61 angstrom. So that is solid evidence that there is really, so the X-halves here describes the crystal structure of the azido complex well. And the photolysis product definitely has that short iron-nitrogen bond. So there is good evidence there is an iron 5 species and it has a short iron-nitrogen bond. That's great. Now, at this time, these were the cradle days of DFT calculation, so already this was an adventure to calculate a molecule like this. So now that is something that you do in 20 minutes on laptop, but at the time it was quite an adventure to do that. And so at the time we were able to calculate the energy and the Mössbauer parameters and the structure, of course. And so you see we had quite good agreement between the Mössbauer and the calculation for the azide complex that we know crystallographically, and then we tried for quite a long time to calculate the photolysis product in an S equal 3/2 state. And we just couldn't do it. We just couldn't swing it. I mean, there was no agreement with the experiment whatsoever until we went, and I think I did that out of ignorance, that I accidentally calculated spin 1/2 state here, and it was not only much lower in energy, but all of a sudden it had Mössbauer parameters where the calculation really matched the experiment pretty well. And also, like, these things differ dramatically in their vibrational frequency. So here the iron N frequency was 670 wave numbers, and here it's 940 wave numbers. So that means new hypothesis was it is an iron 5, but it's not a spin 3/2, it's a spin 1/2. And we managed to do some magnetic susceptibility measurements that is much more forgiving than EPR here. And indeed, this is the experiment, it's the open dots, and the black line is a simulation with a spin 1/2, and this is a simulation with a spin 3/2. So it is absolutely clear then from this experiment that the ground state spin of the iron 5 nitrido is 1/2 and not the expected 3/2, right? And you would not have expected that, because if you have an octahedral side of D3, then is you expect it to be high spin, right? And so that is why we never looked for it. Like, we are overeducated by ligand field theory. We knew that an octahedral D3 side should be high spin, right? But it wasn't. And the vibrational frequency could not be measured by RR or Raman, and then we didn't succeed doing that. But we were able to measure it by nuclear resonance vibrational spectroscopy again, in collaboration with Serena, and I know that these were very hard experiments. Then Serena tells me the story, I think when she took that data, she didn't sleep for 38 hours, and that was dedication. It is still dedication, and it was worth it, and these data were very nice. You can also calculate these spectra very nicely, and they showed without a shadow of doubt that you have this peak here at around, the calculation gives a vibrational frequency slightly too high, but it's clear that it's a spin 1/2 that is in agreement with the experiment, and the spin 3/2 absolutely isn't. So it's clear to rule out the 3/2, and I think the experimental evidence is solid that this thing really is a spin 1/2 species. And then after dickety-duck times trying, we also got like a really nice EPR spectrum, well, much, much nicer EPR spectrum that also showed that the iron 5 really has a nice, very unusual, but very nice spin 1/2 EPR spectrum. The analysis of this is complicated, and I won't go into it, but the experiment is there yet. Now, summarizing that, now, the reason then, of course, why that thing is a spin 1/2 ground state is that the nitrido forms an obnoxiously strong pi bond with the metal, and that means the splitting between the dxy orbital and the xzyz pair is extremely strong, and so that's why it's energetically favorable to form the S 1/2 state over the S 3/2 state. Okay, and of course, since the XZ and YZ orbitals are degenerate, then you only have one electron in them, you have a doublet E state, that's Jahn-Teller active, and so you have like a really nasty Jahn-Teller problem, and that is accounts for the fact that the EPR is so complicated and so hard to get. So that is essentially the story. Now, it has also interesting reactivities over the years. We have on and off followed up on that, and one interesting reaction that we observed is the NN coupling reaction from nitrido to give N2, so the inverse Haber-Bosch reaction. And to this end, we have labeled the azide with 15N, and you can only buy it with terminally labeled nitrogen. And of course, then you will statistically form the azide complex with N15 bound to the iron and N15 like terminal. Now, when you do the photolysis, then you expect you do 50% N15 nitrido and 50% N14 nitrido. Now, and if there is a bimolecular decay reaction, you would expect 25% N14 nitrogen, then you would 50% 15-14 dinitrogen and 25% 15-15 dinitrogen. And we did these mass spec experiments very carefully. That was our PhD student Oliver Krah in close collaboration with Eckhardt. And it was clear we had some dilution from dinitrogen air, but it was absolutely clear that we form 15-15 dinitrogen. And that can only happen if the two nitrogens of the nitridos really couple in a bimolecular reaction to give you N2. There isn't much to talk about in terms of the mechanism of this reaction, at least according to all calculations that we have done. This is a calculation that proceeds without any barrier, and it goes hugely downhill, and it immediately forms N2 via such a dinuclear compound that, however, is not a discrete intermediate on the potential energy surface. And then after releasing dinitrogen, the iron 2 binds acetonitrile, and that is then what you can observe spectroscopically as a reaction result. So that is some interesting chemistry. I could dig further into that, but I won't, because there's something else I wanted to tell you about. That chemistry, however, back in the day, that went further, and it was John Barry, when he was a postdoc in Mülheim, he kept on studying these reactions. And what he did, he made a methyl derivative of the cyclam acetate, and he was studying the photochemistry of that compound. And so the attempted reaction was clear. I mean, we thought, now we understand it, and we just like bind azide, and then we like make iron 5. And John has been trying and trying and trying and trying, and he never made iron 5, he only made iron 2. But after quite some work, he managed to make an iron 4 azide compound. That's a very interesting compound that he then published together with Carl in Jax, an iron 4 azide complex. And we said, okay, that's so cool, let's measure the resonance Raman spectrum of that. And so that we did at the time, and so we had like our EPR vial that we put into the resonance Raman, and then the technician came to me and said like, well, it's not working, it's like bleaching all the time and color is changing and it's like, oh crap. And then we thought, okay, oh no, that's interesting. Then let's see what we have made here, like in the resonance Raman beam. So, and we thought, yeah, probably it's yet another way to make iron 2. But once we put it into the Mössbauer spectrometer, then there was a huge surprise, because that species had an isomer shift of minus 0.3 millimeters per second. So that is the signature of a super high valence state. And we figured it's got to be iron 6. And that was then also confirmed. The X-ray absorption spectroscopy had the pH peak shifted another electron volt higher than the iron 5 nitrido, and the X-halves also showed a short bond. The electronic structure of that compound is easy to describe. It's basically that one electron in the iron 5 nitrido that is sitting in the super antibonding orbital that is happy enough to leave, and you form a nice D2 complex here that is happily sitting there, and it's not even doing much. I think at some point we formed it up in the Mössbauer and it wasn't even that reactive. But that was then the first real molecular iron 6 complex, and I think it's a combination of spectroscopy and theory that is really unbelievably helpful in figuring that out. So I guess I have a little bit of time left, so I want to spend another 10-15 minutes to go to the other side of oxidation states and show you something that we've recently done. So, and that is the chemistry, presumably the chemistry of iron 1 and iron 0. And the context here is the activation of CO2. So you know that I won't give you the CO2 propaganda. We all know why CO2 is evil and how we need to get rid of it and how that requires catalysis and all that. And CO2 really is a very nasty molecule to activate because it really doesn't want to activate. It has very high lying, it's a shitty ligand, so it really doesn't want to bind to transition metals. And so pretty much the only way to activate this is to put electrons into it, but it really doesn't want to have electrons into it. So to reduce CO2 by one electron, you have to go to the crazy potentials of -1.9 volts or even worse. Then the best way to achieve that is to bend CO2. So because once CO2 is bent, like one of the pi star orbitals here, the LUMOs are pi star orbitals, they come way down in energy once you bend the CO2, and then it is way more susceptible to accepting an electron. However, bending costs you a lot of energy, so only to go from 180 to 120 degrees costs you something like 40 kcal, so that's also not something that's easily achieved. Now, of the ways that CO2 can be activated, the two most important mechanisms are the following. It's a hydrogenation to formate or formic acid with H2, and that proceeds via hydride transfer. Shengfa has studied that a lot, and we have an interesting story to tell about that, but I will not tell that part of the story. Instead, I want to tell the other part of the story, and that is the reduction of CO2 to CO. And that proceeds by proton-coupled electron transfer, and that can be done by electrochemistry. And so that would give CO2 plus two protons plus two electrons give you CO and water. And it's one of the many catalysts who can do that is, in fact, a compound as simple as iron TPP. And that has been studied by Jean-Michel Savion and his collaborators for a long, long time. And they're showing the following, that in the CV, you can take the iron TPP, you have a reduction wave from iron 3 to iron 2, from iron 2 to iron 1, from iron 1 to iron 0, and then a catalytic current sets in where CO2 is converted to CO and water. And so that is nice, and we figured there was basically no spectroscopy done on that, nothing, no theory, and so we figured that's interesting. So we wanted to look into the reduced forms of these iron porphyrins and see whether we can understand something about that chemistry. And we opened Pandora's damn box here. Then had we known that, probably we wouldn't have started. Then it's already then the iron 2 TPP is like an endless headache because it can consist in all kinds of different conformations, and then it adds this ligand or that ligand or another ligand, and every time like it ends up in one of these different conformations, all the properties change, and so you have a hard time figuring out what is what. So Eckhart can probably tell you much more about it, and he has suffered way more through all of that than I have, but I think in the end we have sorted it out. And so here are three forms of the iron TPP: a ruffled core, a saddle core, or planar core. And you see they have different properties. So that has ground state total spin of 1 with these Mössbauer parameters. That also has a ground state spin of 1, but with different Mössbauer parameters, much larger quadrupole splitting, whereas once you weakly coordinate THF, you go to ground state spin of 2 and completely different Mössbauer parameters. Now, Tina Rümmelt, who was instrumental to do the chemistry in the lab, she managed then also to make the reduced forms of these iron porphyrins and characterize them, and they're extremely labile compounds. But what she managed then, so she found when she is reducing these these porphyrins with sodium anthracenide to get the mono and dianions, then that sodium THF is actually sticking here to the iron porphyrin. But then she could get rid of those by adding a crown ether. And that's nice because that made the chemistry clean enough to really spectroscopically characterize these reduced forms of the porphyrin. And so we did our usual gig. So first thing here is to study the X-ray absorption spectroscopy, and that is of course what you've seen before, like in the cyclam series, one electron volt per oxidation state. So we were well equipped with good expectations of what to expect here when we go to the reduced porphyrins, and what we saw was absolutely nothing. And so these porphyrins here, they all, the iron TPP, the iron TPP minus, and the iron TPP 2 minus, so the mono and the dianion, they all have their pre-H peak at the exact same energy at 7,111 electron volts. So they all have the same valence state of iron, and all of these iron is iron 2. So that's interesting, because we still have some chemistry to explain. Then the Mersbauer, and the Mersbauer is confirming that, so there are limited changes here in both the isomer shift and the quadrupole splitting, but essentially the Mersbauer is consistent with all of these three compounds having iron in an intermediate spin state of S equal 1. And we can also figure out from the Mersbauer that the overall spin in the FeTPP 2 minus is S equals 0, while for the 1 minus the monoanion is a spin 1/2. Okay, so can we correlate that with calculations? Yes, we could. And so we have good agreement with calculations. And in all of these calculations, the iron is in the iron 2 state. And so the reduction really is happening at the porphyrin that goes to a porphyrin radical and a porphyrin diradical. Good, so if that is the case, then we should be able to get some experimental evidence for that. And so we have looked at the iron, and now we need a spectroscopy to look into the porphyrin to figure out whether that could possibly be reduced. And that spectroscopy, of course, then is resonance Raman spectroscopy. And here we could rely on some really beautiful work that Tom Spiro has done like many, many years ago. And so what he has done is to take zinc porphyrin and reduce it by one electron, so where it's absolutely clear that the reduction is happening at the porphyrin. And so from that work, we know the characteristic shifts in all of these porphyrin marker bands that also Spiro has worked out in great detail. So there is nothing that is jumping out at you, I understand that, but like here we rely on an analysis that Tom Spiro has really carefully done a long, long time ago. So you see that like there are marker bands that shift by about 20 wave numbers upon reduction. And that is then what we really see also in our experiments. So when we go from the FeTPP to the FeTPP minus to the FeTPP 2 minus, so let's just focus on these two bands here, nu 10 and nu 29. They shift just basically exactly as we expected with macrocycle reduction. So all of these shifts are consistent with macrocycle reductions. And we also have quantum chemical calculations that do reproduce the resonance Raman spectra. I would weigh reasonably well to excellent, and so basically we have confidence that the electronic structure that we're calculating here really is consistent with what we observe in the experiment. Sorry, I'm a bit fast here, but I'll be done in a few minutes. Okay, so basically of all the alternative electronic structures that we have, so for the monoanion, we could either have an iron iron 2, or we can have an iron 1. But what's really happening here is that the iron is iron 2 in an intermediate spin state, antiferromagnetically coupled to a porphyrin radical, where one electron is sitting in the pi star LUMO of the TPP. And the dianion, analogously, is then best described as an iron 2 in an intermediate spin state, and the iron, the TPP in a triplet state, so a triplet state with two electrons in the LUMO antiferromagnetically coupled to the iron. So this is how that looks like in terms of orbitals, and then you have the antiferromagnetic coupling between the iron DXE and then the E pi star orbitals of the porphyrin. Now what does it mean in terms of reactivity then? So we've also that started to calculate these reaction pathways, and so the way it works basically is that you go here from the FeTPP2-, you bind CO2, and in that process, one electron is transferred from the porphyrin to the CO2 to give you an intermediate that is Fe2-TPP3-, and then CO2- that immediately gets protonated, so that's the first proton-coupled electron transfer. And then you need to have a proton donor, and that proton donor donates a second proton there, and that proton goes with a second proton-coupled electron transfer to give you H2O and water. Yeah, and so that is the rate-limiting step, is the second one where you transfer a proton from the proton donor to finally give you CO and water. And throughout, the iron is not really changing its oxidation state at all. So essentially, now since the CO2 is binding to the iron and not to the porphyrin, so the iron is essentially acting as an electron relay that is shoveling, is basically conducting the electrons from the porphyrin ring to the CO2. That is essentially what we think we have learned here from that chemistry and spectroscopy. So we draw the following mechanism that we have the reduced iron porphyrin, we bind CO2, the first proton-coupled electron transfer gives us first CO2-, then protonated CO2-, and then under the action of a proton donor, we go to products, dissociate it, etc. Okay, so that is my story. So we went through a lot of iron chemistry, and the theme throughout was that I was emphasizing to use spectroscopy as the experimental tool to study electronic structure and then combine that with quantum chemistry to obtain insight in the geometric structure, in the electronic structure, and then correlate that with reactivity. I hope you found that interesting, and we have a few minutes left. Perhaps if there's one or the other question, I'm happy to answer that. Thank you very much for your attention. Hi, Thomas.
So when you calculate your MCD intensities for the oxide 4, I noticed the amine was like a order of magnitude weaker than the chlorine. Can you do nearby charge transfer sizes?
No, they're not. We don't even have them in the calculation. These are CASSE-CF and FPD2 calculations, and we only had the d orbitals active, so we wouldn't have seen the LMCT. To be perfectly honest, we were happy enough to have the science right. you know how hard that is. It depends on all kinds of small distortions and DP mixing, et cetera. So I would be lying if I told you that I had an explanation for that. Then. Yeah. Yeah.
So I was curious about the hydroxyl. Well, in the oxochemistry, when you're doing the two-state reactivity, it seems like you're well primed to do a radical rebound, especially by going to the open shell platform and traversing the amine-based scaffold. However, none of those compounds do hydroxylation. They just do the H-atom abstraction. That's basically the... So can you explain that, or is there something that underlies that work?
It's a good point. I don't know why they don't rebound. Then it's maybe if you would keep the radical around long enough, they would, but this happening in solution, and probably the radical is reacting with itself or the solvent or so before anything can happen. Enzymes are great, right? Because enzymes just hold the thing there and say, you're not going anywhere until I've stuck the hydroxide back onto you. But that is the most I'm hand waving here, but that's I think it's a likely scenario. Marty, do you have?
Yeah, so you're kind of going toward a nebulous question that I've been formulating probably over the last year, many years. And that is that to what extent are these computational analyses of a simple step like a hydrogen transfer, they're geometry optimized. When you think about it in solution, you have a trajectory and that can vary a little bit, but an enzyme can enforce a really bad trajectory. So is there any analysis of, you know, the energetics of such a step in a really unfortunate geometry that an enzyme might force the
I found it very interesting that you called that like a muddy question in your mind, because I found that very often when it comes to enzyme reactivity, it ends up in a very muddy discussion on protein dynamics of one kind or another. And like, I basically take nothing home from these discussions, nothing. And so an enzyme is obviously something very complicated and is a dynamic thing, right? So when we do these computations, we use, of course, rely on transition state theory, Ehring's transition state theory. And that is identifying discrete points on the potential energy surface that we then relate to reaction rates, right? As the way we have learned that. And there is nothing different in an enzyme as it is in a zeolite or it's in anything else. And of course, the transition state theory is a more or less primitive substitute for all the molecular dynamics that is actually happening, right? So when you do these molecular dynamics calculations, you can extract these rates from the MD if you like sample long enough, etc. And then the agreement, depending on how you do it with the transition state theory, is not bad. There are isolated and well-defined cases where transition state theory itself breaks down, and then there is no agreement, but then you need to go to very elaborate quantum dynamics. So, but basically take it that the transition state theory, once you find the right transition states, is a substitute for all that dynamics that has happened. So if you go back to like Ehring's reasoning, then he was really smart. He knew all these things, right? Nobody thinks like this thing is rigid and this thing is rigid and then they go boom and then they meet and then you go, it's naive to think that like the reaction would go this way. It goes like, it like tries to reach the transition state, one trajectory, another trajectory, third trajectory, and so many of them are successful. And all of that statistics is in principle built into the Ehring theory.
Yeah, I want to come back to one of your very early statements.
Yes.
That was that crystallography cannot show you any dynamics.
No, I have not said that, and I don't mean that. No, you're putting words in my mouth. I haven't said that.
So my question is not concerning the last molecule because it's a cyclic reaction. So the catalyst should be unharmed in this reaction. Can you do this reaction in crystals?
Sorry?
Can you do this reaction in crystals?
No. This is an electrochemical reaction. It's happening at the surface of an electrode.
So you cannot?
I cannot, no.
So has anybody been able to do a chemical reaction in crystals without
dissolving? I think, yeah, well, quite typically the crystal will break apart, but I mean, you know better than me, right? I'm not a crystallographer. There are certainly a few reactions that have been run in a crystal. There are also enzymes that are still active in the crystalline state.
Yeah, enzymes we know well about, and looking for model compounds.
Model compounds. Any crystallographer here who wants to comment on that? I
am aware of like some interesting things that people do photochemistry in a crystal. For example, they can flash light and then they flip a cyanide ligand from C bound to N bound, and then you can do all kinds of femtosecond resolved crystallography. That's awesome. Then is. But a general chemistry analysis tool, this will never be.